Hi, I'm Iain, and today we're going to talk about how to build a static phase converter. Why do I have a static phase converter, you ask? Well, it's because I have a 3-horsepower, 3-phase re-alarm saw, and just like all the other houses I've ever seen, I don't have 3-phase service at my house. So I needed a way to run it. Now, the popular way to run 3-phase equipment at your house nowadays, according to online, is either with a variable frequency drive or a rotary phase converter. And there are pros and cons to each of those things. First, the variable frequency drive. The variable frequency drive is really designed to give a 3-phase motor variable speed. An induction motor's speed is fixed to the frequency of the AC voltage going to it. So in the US, it's 60 Hertz coming out of the wall, and depending on how you design the motor, you give it 60 Hertz, it gives you a certain RPM. The only way to change that is to change the frequency of the AC you give it. So a variable frequency drive is designed to do that. Well, the way they do that, simply put, is they take the AC coming in and convert it into DC. 0 Hertz, it's just flat line. They take that DC and now, through an inverter, make 3 phases of alternating current. And now they can time it to whatever you want to give you whatever frequency out you want, variable frequency. So you're no longer stuck with 60 Hertz. It can be whatever you want, as long as the variable frequency drive can handle that frequency output, you can have that frequency output. So you have variable speed to your motor. Well, an interesting side effect of them taking the alternating current coming in and turning it into DC and then turning it into 3-phase power, the motor and the variable frequency drive doesn't care if you give it 3 phases or just 2 phases. It converts it to DC and then converts it to 3-phase AC. Because of that, you can use it as a phase converter and it'll spit out 3-phase power and the motor will be all happy. Yes, you will draw slightly more current on your single phase line than you would if you had it attached to 3 phases, because you've gone from 3 to 2, but the motor doesn't care. It's all happy. You're all happy until you look at the price tag of that thing. Variable frequency drives are expensive. There's another method, the tried and true rotary phase converter. Simply put, a rotary phase converter is a big motor, usually called an idler motor, that sits in a dusty corner somewhere and idles. All it does is it sits there and spins. Fun fact about 3-phase motors. If you can get a 3-phase motor to spin and you give it single phase power, it will keep on spinning in the direction it started in. If you just give it single phase power to begin with, it just sits there and hums and eventually bursts into flames. But if you can make it rotate first and give it a direction to go, it'll keep on going. How you make it start is totally up to you. I've seen rotary phase converters that had a little 1/4 horsepower motor belt driven onto the shaft of the 3-phase motor. So you turn on the 1/4 horsepower motor first, spins up the big motor, you give it 2 phases, and it acts like a generator and out pops a 3rd phase. The stator in the 3-phase motor combined with the 3 field windings will actually output 240 volts on the missing leg. Now there's a downside to this. The downside is you're using a motor as a generator. Its voltage regulation isn't going to be super great, so in order to try and regulate that 3rd leg and stabilize it a bit, you take what's called run capacitors, which are oil-filled capacitors, and you put them between that generated wild leg and the other two legs, and you get the sizes just right, you tune it up real well, and you can get that wild leg to have the same voltage as the other two, or really, really close to it. The nice thing about a rotary phase converter is that you can run an entire shop of equipment off that rotary phase converter. So at that point, once you start that thing up, it's like you have three-phase power in your shop. You can have as many three-phase outlets as you want, as long as none of the motors you try to start off of it are bigger than the idler motor, they should all start and run just fine. Hooray for you, hooray for it. The downside to it is unless you can get a big three-phase motor free or super, super cheap, it's going to be almost as expensive as the variable frequency drive. And depending on how much it costs for the little oil-filled run capacitors, it could be more than the variable frequency drive. And really, if all you have to run is one piece of equipment, going through the hassle of building a rotary phase converter, probably not worth it. So, there is another method called a static phase converter. And a static phase converter is essentially a motor starter. Now there's two different types of static phase converters. There's the balanced phase converter, and then there's the simple phase converter. I'm going to be talking about the simple phase converter. The simple phase converter is just a motor starter. Remember how I said a three-phase motor will keep turning if you give it just single phase as long as you get it spinning to begin with? Well, that's what the simple static phase converter does. It basically uses that third winding, because you have your single phase 240 volts hooked up to two of the windings. The third winding is treated like a start winding on a regular split phase motor, and it starts the motor. As soon as the motor gets up to speed, it disconnects that third winding, and the motor is off and running on just two windings. Now, there's a downside to this. One is the motor doesn't run quite as smoothly because it's expecting three windings to be running, and you're only running it on two. The other downside is you lose a third of the horsepower. So, in my case, my 3-horsepower radial arm saw acts like a 2-horsepower radial arm saw because I'm only running it on two of the motor windings. However, for a lot of things, like my radial arm saw, I use it at home. I'm not a production shop. I don't need all 3 horsepower out of the thing because I've used it with a 10-inch dado head taking a 1-inch wide cut before, and it's been perfectly fine. It doesn't bog down at all. So if you don't need full nameplate horsepower, a static phase converter, a simple static phase converter, is a super cheap and easy way to do it. And I've been running mine for 10 years on it, and it's been okay. The balanced phase converter is like the idler motor in that it has oil-filled capacitors that go between the two legs coming out of the wall and that third motor winding. So it still has a start capacitor to get the thing started. It disconnects the start capacitor, and then those other two are off and running. The downside is it takes a bit of work to fine-tune that to run with your motor. And the issue is you've got to have a whole bunch of these oil-filled run capacitors that you can swap out and try different combinations and look at it with a clamp-on amp meter to try and get everything to balance out. Unless you know somebody at a motor shop that can loan you a whole bunch of oil-filled capacitors to try it out with, you don't want to buy a whole box of those things to mix and match and then only end up using half of them. So it's way easier and cheaper to just make one of these simple ones like I'm going to show you and be done with it. So let's take a look at what it takes to build a simple phase converter. Here you have the simplest of all phase converters, the static phase converter. Now, the first thing to understand with this one is it's really not a phase converter at all. It's a motor starter, and that's it. It starts the motor, and then the motor is off and running on just single phase power. Here we have the motor. This one is a delta wound motor, so you can see the three different field windings meet in the middle. Hooray for them. You have the motor contactor, whether this is a mechanical switch with three contacts that close all three legs at the same time and disconnect all three legs at the same time, or a magnetic starter. Whatever it is, the original equipment switch still needs to be in place. So, ignoring this is original. Motor switch, whatever it is, all original, three phase here. Here we have the static phase converter. And the static phase converter really, really is about as simple as it can possibly get. It just has three parts in it. You have a 15K ohm, so 15,000 ohm, 5 watt resistor, a motor start capacitor, and a relay. That's it, three parts, all it is. Ta-da, you can start your motor with just three simple parts. Let's talk about these parts. The heart of the thing is the start capacitor. And the bigger the motor, the bigger the start capacitor needs to be. The start capacitor is responsible for passing alternating current from leg 1 to leg 3. The reason it needs to be a capacitor and not just shorted together is you need a phase shift. And the way you get a phase shift for alternating current is either with an inductor or a capacitor. In this case, we're using a capacitor because that's what you typically use for a motor starter. So you have your motor start capacitor. Finally, you have your relay, because motor start capacitors are not motor run capacitors. They will get hot and they will explode if you leave them connected too long. These are momentary devices. They're made to get the motor spinning and then disconnect. That's what the relay is for, because on a regular capacitor start single phase motor, there's usually a centrifugal switch on here that once the motor gets up to speed, the switch disconnects the capacitor. And if the switch sticks over time, the capacitor blows up and it smells weird. But normally, the switch opens at a certain speed, disconnects the capacitor, and the motor's off and running. Well, this is a three-phase motor. There's no centrifugal switch. So, what we use is a relay. And if you want to be all technical about it, we're using this as a potential relay. What that means is we're essentially using the coil of the relay to sense the voltage between leg 1 and leg 3. As I said earlier, with a three-phase motor, if it's running on two phases, that third leg, it'll act like a generator, and voltage will appear on that third leg being generated out of this motor. So if we supply it leg 1 and leg 2 to 40 volts, when this thing gets up to speed, if we measure from this leg to either one of these, we will get something really, really close to 240 volts. If we use a relay with a 240 volt coil, and note it has to be an AC rated relay, otherwise it's going to sit there and chatter. But as long as it has a coil rated for 140 volts AC, once this thing gets up to about 75-80% of its RPMs, it will have generated enough voltage here to open this normally closed relay contact. So, let's say this thing is off right now. So, the motor contactors are open, nothing's happening. As soon as you close these, so you connect this one, and this one, they're all connected. That normally closed relay contact is already closed because when there's no voltage applied to this coil, the spring is holding it closed, which means this capacitor and the resistor are now connected from L1 to L3, leg 1 to leg 3. So this motor sees power on leg 1, leg 2, and through the capacitor, you get this phase shift, so it's slightly out of phase with leg 1 appearing on leg 3. As far as the motor knows, it is looking at three-phase power, and it starts spinning. As it gets up to speed, it starts generating back EMF, which essentially means it now starts working like a generator to try and oppose the current going in the winding. At some point, usually around 75 to 80% of its rated RPM, it's generating enough back EMF to be able to measure close to 240 volts between these two. Once the voltage gets to 240 volts between these two, there's enough current flowing through the 240 volt relay coil to open up this contact. So this contact opens up, which disconnects the capacitor from leg 3. At that point, the only thing on leg 3 is this relay coil. As long as this motor keeps spinning at 75% of its RPMs or higher, it keeps generating the 240 volts to keep this thing open. It holds that relay open as long as that thing spins. Here's where the resistor comes in. You don't want to have a capacitor charged up to 240 volts with nothing attached to it, because if it's a really good capacitor, it will hold that voltage for days or weeks or months, depending on how good the thing is, and there's an issue with that. If you were to touch those terminals, you'll get zapped with 240 volts, even though the thing's just sitting there disconnected. Now, motor start caps are notoriously not high quality, so that's not as much of an issue as causing this thing to chatter when you shut it off. Either way, you want to have a big capacitor with a bleeder resistor on it. That's what this is referred to. The idea is when this contact opens up, it breaks the circuit, this thing's still attached to the capacitor. Whatever voltage is stored in this capacitor at the moment that thing opens can slowly dissipate through that resistor, and it goes back down to 0 volts. So it's spinning, spinning, spinning. You're cutting lots of wood with your rail arm saw or whatever this thing is running. Yay for you. Well, eventually you're going to run out of wood to cut and you're going to turn it off. So the contactor opens up, disconnect, disconnect, disconnect. Motor's just freewheeling at that point. Well, remember, this thing's open. You just opened this up. You now have a relay coil connected to nothing. So, no more current, no more magnet, relay contacts close. Nothing happens because this resistor has bled off all the voltage from the start capacitor. If this wasn't here and this was disconnected during running, so you don't blow up your capacitor, that thing could be sitting there holding 240 volts. When you disconnect the rest of it, suddenly this thing doesn't have any current flowing through it because you just disconnected it. Relay contact could drop. When it connects, now you have 240 volts stored up in this capacitor. It can flow through the relay coil. As soon as it starts flowing through the relay coil, contact opens up. As soon as it opens up, magnetic field goes away, contacts close. Whatever's left in the capacitor starts flowing again. It'll sit there and chatter, and you'll burn up your relay in a hurry. By having the bleeder resistor, not only are you protecting yourself from getting zapped across that thing if you come in contact with it, you're also protecting the relay contacts so they don't sit there and chatter at the end. So the bleeder resistor is important. Now, the reason it's 15,000 ohms at 5 watts is that value at 240 volts. It ends up being, I think, 3.2 watts it dissipates, so it's not a whole lot of power You want a 5-watt resistor so you don't burn out your resistor, because if that burns out, it essentially goes away, and now you're back to the chattering relay. The other thing you want to be careful of with this thing, you want to make sure you disconnect it here. Don't think, now that you're just running it off single-phase power, that you can hardwire this thing in and just use a two-pole switch out here. Technically, you can do that, but it's going to hate your guts. The reason for that is if this thing is not disconnected from the motor, so this is connected all the time, you shut off power out here, as that motor spins down, eventually it's going to get below 75% of its RPMs, and the voltage between leg 1 and leg 3 has dropped enough that this is able to let go, and that contact closes. A lot of times, once this capacitor is hooked back in to that motor spinning down, it is able to generate enough power on leg 1 and leg 3 to cause that relay contact to open back up. And then suddenly, without that capacitor helping, voltage droops, closes back down, up, down, up, down, up, down. It chatters again. So to prevent that relay contact from dying a premature death, you want to have the starting and the stopping of the motor happen between leg 1, leg 3, and leg 2, just like it always did. Have the AC line come in, leg 1, leg 2, phase converter, motor contactor, then motor. Okay, so now what do we need for the relay? The relay can be any relay that has a 240 volt AC coil and has a normally closed contact rated at the amperage that the motor needs. For the price of relays, I'd just slap a 30 amp relay on this thing and call it good no matter what horsepower it is, because that'll even handle 7.5 horsepower. It might even handle 10. So that's the relay, that's the resistor. The start capacitor is the biggie. That has to be chosen for the size motor. Now the nice thing is, unlike the balanced one with run capacitors here, there, and everywhere, this one is much more forgiving. So we can use a simple equation to figure out the capacitor for that, and there's a 99% chance it works the very first time. So let's see what that is. So here we have the super simple equation for the super simple static phase converter. The start capacitor needs to be between 70 to 100 microfarads per horsepower. So capacitors are always in farads. In this case, we're in the microfarad range, and we want between 70 and 100 per horsepower. So you take the horsepower of your motor, multiply it by 70, and multiply it by 100, and pick a capacitor that's in that range somewhere. So an ideal capacitor for a 3-horsepower motor would be, on the low end, 210 microfarad, and on the high end, 300 microfarad. For 5-horsepower, on the low end would be 350, on the high end would be 500 microfarad. Now, here's the thing with motor start capacitors. They are sold in varying steps, and they always give a range. The reason for that is they are not precision components. They're just kind of thrown together, and as long as it's in this ballpark, hooray for it, hooray for you, ta-da. A common size for a start capacitor is one rated 270 to 324 microfarad. That means the one you buy, it's going to be in this range somewhere. They don't really know where it is in that range when they manufacture it. They don't really care, because it's going to start the motor no matter what. This is not delicate electronics. This is just start motor with brute force and ignorance. So that's what they're sold as, a 270 to 324 microfarad start capacitor. That is in the range of the 3 horsepower one. That's the closest one we can get. So that's what we would use for a 3 horsepower motor. That's what I use on my 3 horsepower rail arm saw. Hooray for it. For a 5 horsepower one, remember we want something 350 to 500. Well, the closest one they sell in a common size is 400 to 480. That's right in that range. That'll work perfectly for a 5 horsepower one. If you have a different horsepower, all you got to do is multiply it by 70, multiply it by 100. That gives you your range, and you just choose the capacitor that is closest to that range. Let's go take a look at the phase converter. I've pulled my radial arm saw away from the wall, and I've got this junction box here. It's a 6-inch by 6-inch junction box, 4 inches deep, and if we look inside it, we will see a static phase converter. We have the relay, we have the start capacitor, and if you look way back in there, there is the 15k ohm 5 watt bleeder resistor across the terminals of the start capacitor. We have the single phase 240 volt line coming in. That's the repurposed extension cord. And then we have the pretend 3-phase coming out, and that travels up this cord right here to the motor contactor in here. Now this thing has a transformer in it because the contactor uses a 24 volt coil. The transformer has to be wired between leg 1 and leg 2 because those are the ones that have power on it all the time. Otherwise it's not going to work if I try to go from leg 1 to leg 3 because there really is no leg 3. So just be aware, if you have a magnetic starter on your device, the coil or the transformer, depending on what your setup is, has to be wired across leg 1 and leg 2 because those are the only ones powered all the time. But other than that, there is absolutely no difference. I could just take this 3-phase cord, and if I had 3-phase power here, I could just plug it into the wall and the saw would run just fine. Don't have to modify it at all. This goes between the wall and the saw. Okay, now the thing everybody's going to ask, where do you get the parts? Well, I got the capacitor, this little bracket for the capacitor to hold it in this junction box, and the relay on McMaster Car's website. And again, once I figured out I need a 270 microfarad to 324 microfarad capacitor, I went on there, and that's what I picked, along with the correct bracket. It was all on the same line for accessories. They also offered an insulating cap for the top. Don't need insulating cap because I've got a big resistor sticking out of it, and it's in a metal box, so I think it's okay. And for 10 years, it's been okay. So that's where I got that. Same thing with the relay. Made sure it had a normally closed contact, a 240 volt coil, and the current rating was the same rating as the current draw for the motor. So there was that. The junction box I also got off the McMaster Car website. Again, this is a 6-inch by 6-inch square box, 4 inches deep, and it has a bunch of knockouts, which are great for putting the strain relief clamps for the wires. The only thing I couldn't get from McMaster Car was the 15k ohm 5 watt bleeder resistor, and that I got off DigiKey's website, although you can probably find it off Amazon as well. 10 years ago when I built this thing, if Amazon was a thing, I don't remember it being a thing. And if it was a thing back then, it only had books on it. So you might be able to get this stuff off Amazon, but I do know for a fact McMaster Car has everything but the resistor. But again, you want the resistor. Don't try to use it without the resistor. The relay will hate you, and if you ever have to do maintenance on this thing, you will hate you as well. So I hope this video has cleared up how to build your very own phase converter. Again, it's really simple. It's a box with a relay, capacitor, and resistor in it. It's three parts. This, with the box, the strain reliefs, the plate, everything, all brand new, was $50. I just priced out what it would cost for a 5-horsepower version, and that ended up being just under $85. So for less than $100, you can get your saw up and running. And like I said, for the last 10 years, this thing's been completely reliable. This is the first time I've had this cover off. I was actually expecting more sawdust in it than that.